All right, welcome to this demonstration. In this demonstration, I'm going to show you a typical day in the life of an engineer using OrCAD Capture, how you go from checking out a design to using parts, placing parts, grabbing parts, and confirming them. So let's start. Here we are in Capture. We're going to use a tool called EDM, OrCAD Engineering Data Management, and we're going to log into that. This is a system that's going to be hosted locally on your company's network. So this is not internet-based. This is based in your own network. You're going to log into whatever design you want to start working on, and you're going to check that design out. So when you're ready, pick a design that you want to check out, and you're going to pull it locally from your company's network to your local machine. That's going to pull it locally now to my machine, and I can hit open to work on it. At this point, it's just regular capture. So you can log in here. You can take a look at your pages. You can add new parts if you want to and go from there. So let's add some new parts. You can use CIS is what I'm using right here. This is a database that I have with some parts. And I want to search maybe by part type, find some parts that I'm interested in. I can take a look at any part. I can see all the information on that part. I can see alternate manufacturer information. I can see the symbol. I can see the footprint. And I can even come in here and query on a part that I might want to find. So if I want to find a part with a value equals 1 nanofarad, I can do that. And it shows me parts that have 1,000 picofarads. So that's an electrical equivalent, and it matches those as well. It gives me some color coordination here to let me know, to indicate to me visually that these parts right here are maybe not the best ones to pick. The black one is obsolete, the purple one is on order, so maybe parts that I don't want to use in this case. So I'll pick something else besides those ones, double click to place it into my schematic. And once I have the part in my schematic, I can do whatever I want to with it. You'll notice first, if we look at the properties, that all the properties for the part that were in the database that I chose to have come across to the schematic. So I see things like manufacturer part number, PCB footprint, etc. If I want to, though, I can come in here and make changes. We certainly wouldn't recommend that you do make changes, but people often want to. They want to make changes in here, and you can do that. So you can come in here, make changes to your part values or whatever else you want to make changes to, but you've really messed things up at this point, and you want to make sure you change that part correctly. If you proceed along and forget about this, you can always come back, and in the part manager, you can run a synchronization and see if things are in sync, and here it indicates to you that it's not. So C17 is out of sync with the database. Database says it should be 1,000. C17 says it should be 5.6. I'm going to choose not to update that part. I'm going to leave that one alone. And the 3.3, I'm going to choose yes to update that back to what it says it should be in the database. And now it indicates to me that all my parts are in sync with the exception of this 5.6 microfarad part. What I want to do is I want to change that to a different part. So I'm going to link it to an actual 5.6 microfarad part. In this case, the search comes up, but that part is not present for me. I don't have a 5.6 microfarad part. So how do I get one into my database? And that's not hard to do at all. How we're going to do that is open up a tool called CIP. This is the portal for our database. And we can do a distributor search here for a 5.6 microfarad cap that's in stock, ROHS compliant, and lead free. And we'll search for that from DigiKey and Mauser. This is going to do a live web search over those two distributors to find parts that might meet what we're looking for. And we'll sort by price here and try and find something that we think might fit. So let's take a look at this one. This one looks like it might work for us. Let's say that's good enough. That's a fine part. We want to use that part. We can take it and choose to put it into our capacitors table. So we're grabbing the information from DigiKey and putting it into that table. And I'll leave the footprint alone actually at this point. I don't know what it is. But I'll say the schematic part symbol is that one, and that's fine. That's all you need to do to bring your part into the database. And now if we go back to the part manager, we could run that synchronization again. To hook it up to a new part, and we can see now that this part is down here. It's ready to go. I have the symbol, no footprint yet because I haven't assigned one, and I can double click, and it's letting me know there might be some differences. Make sure we know that the connections are still working, and it changes that now from a green light to a yellow light, letting us know that it's been temporarily approved. At this point, you'd want some administrator to come along and actually validate this part. So that administrator could have gotten an email right now, and that email says, go to CIP and log in and check out what happened. So I'll log in with some higher level credentials to check that part. I'm gonna go to the temp parts, and I'll see here that there's this part that the user Matthew has requested. And you can see all the information that's been put in for this part. You can come in and edit the part information, make any changes you want to this part. In my case, all I'm going to do is update the part number to give it the next part number in our sequence that we have here. I'm going to save that off. And that's the only thing you need to do to approve that part. Everything else that's in here could be changed as well if you want to now or later. And in the history, you can see what you've done to this part. So originally Matthew requested it, then the admin came along and changed the part number. At this point, Matthew can get an email, the user Matthew can get an email indicating that the part has been approved, and they'll just come back here to Part Manager, rerun the synchronization, and it'll tell them that temp 20 is now cap 001, and we'll update to that new part. And see that take place. That part has now gone from yellow to green. Okay, what about if a part is a little bit harder to find? A capacitor is pretty easy. We have capacitors drawn. What if we have a more challenging part that we want to use? Let's go again off to CIP. Let's go into the distributor search. I'm going to search Mauser for a part that's a little bit harder to find. And I'm going to take this one. We have some on hand that I want to use, and I want to put this into my IC table. The difference in this case is that I don't have a schematic symbol and I don't have a PCB footprint. So I'm just going to add this part as it is without a schematic and without a footprint, meaning that if I try and place this part, it's going to show up as with no symbol, which isn't going to work out for me. So I need to grab a symbol, and that's where UltraLibrarian comes in. In UltraLibrarian, you can search for a part like this one right here that I just found. And I want to download that symbol. And what this is going to do for me is from ultralibrarian.com, that's an online resource that you can query for existing parts that have already been drawn. I'm going to go there and I'm going to download that symbol. It's already been drawn for me, so I'm going to take it from there. I'm also going to download the footprint, and that's going to generate a script that's going to run in my Allegro or OrCAD software and generate for me an actual footprint. So it's going to go off and run and generate that footprint for me right now. There it is. And it saves that off for me in my directory. So that's great. We can also get the step model as well. The step model will grab now, and that's just download a basic 3D model, and that's going to get downloaded as well into our directory of choice. All right, so we've downloaded the symbol, the footprint, and the step file. Everything's downloaded. Let's attach that to our part here in CIP. We're just going to edit. If we have permission to do so, we're going to paste in the PCB footprint value that we got from UltraLibrarian, and we're going to also paste in the schematic symbol name that we got from it as well. And we can verify that that's correct and verify all the other properties as well just by hitting this footprint viewer. And that'll pop up and show us indeed that it is showing us the correct footprint. And for the symbol, we can view that one as well. And we can see the footprint is available right here. If we want to, we can even place that part. I'm going to open up a page where I have space to place it. And here in CIP, I'll just hit place. And that allows me to place both the A and the B section for that part into my schematic. All right, so that's how you can grab a more complex symbol, one that doesn't have a symbol or a footprint yet in place. You can just download them from UltraLibrarian and use them in your schematic. Let's finish this off by bringing this all back into the EDM tool. So let's save this off and check our design back in so other people can start working on it now if they want to. So I've saved it, I'll close it off. And in the EDM tool, I want to now check this all back in. So to check it in, notice right now it's not able to be checked out by anybody else. You can see who has it checked out. So if you want to follow up with that person and ask them to release it, you can. But If I'm ready, I can hit check in. It's going to ask me, do you want to check in your design? I'm going to say, yes, I do. You can change the status to something else. You can have it automatically generate for you new PDFs, new bill materials, and you can put some notes in here if you want to as well. It's going to auto comment some additional notes, but I'm going to go here and hit OK. That's going to bring my design in. It's also going to generate that PDF. It's also going to generate the bill of materials and upload all that information into the EDM system. So I don't have to generate those files and bring them in myself. So here's the PDF getting generated. And now in EDM, what I should see is I should see that that design is no longer checked out, meaning that someone else can now check it back in. And you can see that that's been cleared now. And if you want to, you can open up the PDF. You can view that PDF. Anybody can. You can just hit open, and that's going to open for you the PDF for this design. Notice on the PDF, you can see all the properties. So here's this part property you can see. You can click on it, and you can view all the parameters that go along with that part as well, or any other part that you have. Here's page 2, and there's our ICs as well. So this PDF is contained now in EDM, so anybody, they don't need to have Capture installed, they can open up this PDF and start looking at it. The bill materials is here as well, and the design is also here. In the design file and any other file that's in EDM, you also get to see the history of this. So everything that's ever been done to this design, you can see it was newly imported, and then I checked it in, and there's telling me the parts that have been added, so C15, 16, 17, U5A, U5B, and I can download this version or any older version if I want to go back in time and see something else. All right, so that's the complete flow, checking out a design from EDM, from your corporate network, placing parts from your corporate network using the CIS tool, adding new parts with CIP, and adding complex new parts, also using UltraLibrarian to grab the symbols, the footprints, and the step files for that, and then checking everything back in, having the PDF auto generated as well as the BOM. So that's a day in the life of the engineer using the Capture environment. Thanks for watching. Let us know if you have any questions. Please contact us. Thank you. Bye-bye.